and focuses to standardize consulting practices in alignment with changing market and industry needs in a dynamic manner. The focus also is to identify areas and industries in which the consultants who are in the profession of management system consulting can contribute to the betterment of the society and the country, and to promote management system consulting in such areas or industries. One of the core objectives is to collaborate with various industry platforms, trade associations, chambers of commerce, management associations, apex bodies of government or quasi-government organization to contribute to the betterment of industry initiatives, which will in turn contribute to the betterment of the society. Next slide, please. About World Accreditation Day 2020, World Accreditation Day is a global initiative established by ILAC and IAF. The theme for this year is How Accreditation Improves Food Safety. Accreditation has an important role in food safety by ensuring competent and impartial inspection, certification, and testing services in all parts of local, national, and international food chains. In doing so, accreditation supports the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, in particular, SDG number 3, that is good health and well-being goal. Accreditation can be applied to a wide variety of assessment, approval, or evaluation tasks, and is used by business, government, and regulators to help deliver a safer world. Next slide, please. Now I request Mr. Alok Jain to explain about TCB division.
Thank you very much, my dear friend Kumar. Good evening, everyone. This is Alok Jain. I am the director and head of Training and Capacity Building Division of Quality Council of India. I appreciate and thank Consultant Consortium of Chennai to celebrate VAT 2020 and giving us an opportunity to introduce the new division of Quality Council of India. As most of you must be aware that Quality Council of India is having various boards responsible for the accreditation of the conformity assessment bodies, like NABCB gives accreditation to certification bodies and inspection bodies. NABL is responsible for the accreditation of laboratories. NABH is for the healthcare providers and hospitals. NABET is in the area of education sectors. And NBQP is for the quality promotion. There is a new division which has been recently created under Quality Council of India called Training and Capacity Building Division, which I am heading. And our main role is to impart the training and do the capacity building division in various domain, right from quality management, food safety, laboratories, inspection, certification bodies, healthcare providers, healthcare, technology, food processing, etc. And we are looking forward to have the association with the government, ministries, regulators, and association to work together for the benefit of the industries. Thank you very much, Kumar, for giving the opportunity.
Thanks, Alok. Next slide, please. The presenter for today is Mr. Ram Kumar and the co-presenter is Mr. Prem Kumar. So I request both presenter and co-presenter to introduce themselves and start the presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Kumar sir. Good evening to everyone. Today's topic is additives and preservatives. And I'm Ram Kumar. I'm basically an undergraduate in botany and postgraduate in quality management and MBA in HR. And I worked for a food industry in Murugappa Group for more than 22 years as a quality head. And now I am a freelance consultant and trainer in food safety standards and lead auditor in various management system standards like QMS, EMS, Occupational Health Safety and Management Systems and ISMS. Also, I am proud to be the Vice President of CCC, Consultants Consortium of Chennai. And I now request my co-presenter, Mr. Prem Kumar, to introduce himself.
Very good evening to all. I am Prem Kumar. Today I am the co-presenter with Mr. Ram Kumar, sir. I am NBQP registered principal consultant for FSMS and I am the managing director of my company, Javin Management Systems and Solutions Private Limited. I have 16 years of industrial experience in management system consultancy implementation in food, feed, packaging, automobile, and engineering industries. I am the lead auditor for BRCGS Packaging, BRCGS Food Safety, and FS20000 lead auditor. Thank you so much. I wish you very all the best to Mr. Ram Kumar for his wonderful presentation.
Thank you, Mr. Prem. So the key facts with respect to these additives, food additives are substances added to maintain or improve its safety, freshness, taste, texture, or appearance. Food additives needs to be checked for potential harmful effects on human health before they can be used. The joint FAO or WHO World Health Organization Expert Committee on Food Additives in short is called as JECFA. Is the international body responsible for evaluating the safety of food additives. Only food additives that have been evaluated and deemed safe by this JECFA, on the basis of which maximum use levels have been established by the Codex Alimentarius Commission, can be used in foods that are traded internationally. So the Codex Alimentarius Commission met in last year, that is 2019, which was the 42nd session, and they have listed out all the food additives which is safer for human consumption. And this is the page which depicts that. And what are food additives? Substances that are added to the food to maintain or improve the safety, freshness, taste, texture, or appearance of food are known as food additives. Some food additives have been in use for centuries for preservation, such as salt, which is used in meats, and sugar in marmalade, or sulfur dioxide in wine. These are all over centuries, mankind has been using these as food additives. And many different food additives have been developed over time to meet the needs of food production, as making food on a large scale is very different from making them on a small scale at home. So what we are doing in the home for preparing the pickles, what our mothers and sisters are doing in our homes, are of a very smaller consumption we are preparing. But when you're deploying that in a larger scale, so definitely it is a different scenario there. And additives are needed to ensure processed food remains safe and in good condition throughout its journey from factories or industrial kitchens, during transportation to warehouses, and ultimately to the shops, and finally at the hands of the consumers, that is we all. So until it reaches our hands, it must be intact and the food quality should never change. So source of additives. Additives may be natural, which are found naturally, such as extracts from beetroot juice. The code is E162, used as a coloring agent. Common salt, used as a preservative in pickles in our country. And man-made versions, synthetic identical copies of substances found naturally, such as benzoic acid, which is E210, that is a code given for that, which is used as a preservative. And artificial, produced synthetically and not found naturally, such as sulfur dioxide, E220, and sorbic acid, E200. So the sources are of different types. And the types of food additives, it may be the direct intentional additives. That is, food additives are those that are added to your food for a specific purpose in that food. For example, xanthan gum, used in salad dressings, chocolate milk, bakery fillings and puddings, and other foods to add texture. So it is a direct intentional additive. And indirect unintentional additives, they are those that become part of the food in trace amounts due to its packaging, storage, or other handling. Examples include radioactive fallout, chemicals used in the agricultural production, and accidental contaminants during food processing. So this is not intentional, but it is all unintentionally happening in the processing. And types of direct food additives: preservatives, food flavors, anti-caking agents, food colors, bulking agents, thickeners, sweeteners, stabilizers, acidulants, humectants, and emulsifiers. And need for food additive. Why there is a need? Why at all the food additive is required for a food? First and foremost purpose is for preservation. Then the nutrition value, the nutritive value of the food. And convenience foods and appealing foods. So the food must appear very appealing. Then only the human, the tongue, which is responsible for craving for the food. Definitely the food must be appealing, and to aid in the processing and preparation of foods. So this is the need. And common food additives, as laid down in the Codex Alimentarius, is tabulated here. It's given, some of the list is given here. And their uses are also given here. For example, aspartame is artificial sweetener, and sodium citrate is pH controller, and sorbitol is nutritive sweetener, and saccharin is artificial sweetener, like on. And the classification of food additives, normally it is classified as colorings. For that, the code is E100 to 199. And preservatives, antioxidants, physical conditioning agents, flavorings, flavor enhancers, sweeteners, and nutritive additives. For nutritive additives, there is no E numbers. I'll explain maybe a little later about what is this labeling, what is this code and all. why this number is given and assigned for different classification of food additives that I will dwell upon in a minute or so. So these are all the range of the code which is being assigned for the different classification of the food additives. So particularly colorings are being used across the food processing industry, and preservatives are also used, and antioxidants, definitely it is all used. Antioxidants act as preservatives by inhibiting the effects of oxygen on food. So the name itself is indicative that it is antioxidant and can be beneficial to health. Example, ascorbic acid, which is a vitamin C, and tocopherols, that is vitamin E. So these are all added as preservatives, which is really beneficial in fact. And chelating agents, they serve as scavengers of metals which catalyze oxidation. Examples, EDTA, ethylene diamine tetraacetic acid, and citric acid. So these are all chelating agents. And in food coloring, colorings are added to food to replace colors lost during preparation. So during food preparation, sometimes what happens, the natural pigments that is prevalent in the food, it loses its color, original color, and because of which the appearance may not be that much bright or that much to the natural environment. So naturally what is happening here is, to make the food attractive, the food colors are added. And natural colorants are caramel coloring, that is E150, and annatto, that is E160B, chlorophyll, cochineal, then betanin extract from beets, turmeric, that is cucurminots, and grape skin extract, etc. There are synthetic colorants are also there, which is listed here. And food coloring, there are some restrictions, and there are some regulatory things which are available as to what is the quantity that needs to be added to your food. That also I'll be explaining in the coming slides. And the anti-foaming agents reduce or prevent foaming in the foods. Examples, polydimethyl siloxane, a type of silicone. Silicone oil is also added to the cooking oil to prevent foaming in deep frying. And curing agents, these are additives used to preserve meats, give them desirable color and flavor, discourage the growth of microorganisms and prevent toxin formation. So the shelf life of the meat also here, it improves because the microorganisms which is growing in the meat, the growth of the microorganisms is totally, it is discouraged. So thereby the shelf life gets improved. Example, sodium nitrate has been used for centuries as a preservative and color stabilizer in meat and fish products. So this is an age-old preservative which is being used in the industry, food industry, particularly the meat and the fish products, seafoods. Emulsifiers allow water and oils to remain mixed together in an emulsion, as in mayonnaise, ice cream, and homogenized milk. The example for an emulsifier is a lecithin. And flavors and flavor enhancers. This is again a very important category of food additive, which is being widely used because we get a lot of this soft drinks are there where the flavors and flavor enhancers are being used. So the flavoring additives are the ingredients both naturally occurring and added, which give the characteristic flavor to the foods. Flavor enhancers are not flavors themselves, but they amplify the flavors of other substances through a synergistic effect. Examples, artificial flavors such as MSG, that is monosodium glutamate, and natural flavors, example, extracted from milk, egg, nuts, etc. So the next category is anti-caking agents. So the anti-caking agents keep powders such as milk powder from caking or sticking. Example, sodium bicarbonate and calcium silicate, calcium aluminosilicate, and bentonite. So these are all anti-caking agents which is widely used. And bulking agents such as starch are additives that increase the mass and volume of your food without affecting its nutritional value. Examples, cellulose, inulin, and polydextrose. So these are all the bulking agents which will increase the mass or the volume of the food. And floor improvers, these are bleaching and maturing agents usually they both bleach and mature the flour. So this is widely used in the atta industry, where they give that that brightness to the atta. It is obtained because of this flour improvers. So freshly milled flour has a yellowish tint and yields a weak duff that produces poor bread. Both the color and baking properties improve by storing the flour for several months before making bread. Example, benzoyl peroxide. Benzoyl peroxide is a flour improver, where the color of the atta is improved and where the storage or the shelf life can be increased to several months. And the leavening agents produce light, fluffy baked goods. Originally, yeast was used almost exclusively to leaven baked products. The yeast was very, very popular, and still now yeast is also used in many pizza and other foods where the bakery industry is totally relying upon the dry yeast or the powdered yeast. It is still an important leavening agent in bread making. When yeast is used, ammonium salts are added to dough to provide a ready source of nitrogen for the yeast growth. So the yeast will grow in the conducive environment for the yeast to grow. The presence of nitrogen is very important. So for that purpose, ammonium salts are added so that it enhances the yeast growth. So this is a leavening agent. And the next category is the humectants. Humectants prevents foods from drying out by retaining the moisture. So it will retain the moisture of the food. And the examples are the glycerol, propylene glycol, and glyceryl triacetate and sorbitol. And preservatives prevent or inhibit spoilage of food due to fungi, bacteria, and other microorganisms, because the food gets contaminated because of these microorganisms and fungi. And to prevent these microorganisms from infesting the food and making the food unfit for consumption, the preservatives are added. Examples, natural preservatives such as vinegar, sugar, and artificial preservatives such as benzoates, nitrates, sulfates, etc. are added as preservatives. And in a sweet industry where a lot of sweets are being prepared, the jeera that is being produced from sugar, it acts as a preservative in gulab jamun and rasgulla and other related sweets. And vinegar is also predominantly used as a preservative in many food processing industry. Stabilizers, thickeners, and gelling agents like agar or pectin, used in jam for example, gives foods a firmer texture. They help to stabilize emulsions. So any emulsion which has to be stabilized and thickened, and it should form as a gel. So these stabilizers are used, and examples are alginic acid, pectin, gelatin, calcium chloride, etc. So the next category of food additives are the acidulants. Food acids are added to make flavors sharper and also acts as preservatives and antioxidants. So there are 84 acidulants which has been used in the food processing industry. Examples are vinegar, citric acid, tartaric acid, malic acid, fumaric acid, and lactic acid. There is a very big long list is there, and you can get the list of these acidulants and their use, what dosage it has to be used. It is all available in the Google. And acid regulators, acidity regulators are used to change or otherwise control the acidity and alkalinity of foods. Examples, acetic acid and citric acid. And next comes the glazing agents. Glazing agents provide a shiny appearance or protective coating to the foods. Example, stearic acid, beeswax, and candelilla wax. So this gives a glossy appearance or a shiny appearance for the, and also gives a protective coating to the food. Normally, wax coating is there in apples. Whatever the apples that what we are getting even in Chennai, it is all coated with a wax. So there was a lot of controversy was going on whether the wax is really whatever they are coating to preserve the, to give you a shiny appearance or a protective coating to the particular fruit. Is it harmful or is it not harmful? Those type of debates are going on even in WhatsApp. Lots of videos were getting circulated in the social media. And floor treatment agents are added to floor to improve its color and its use in baking. The example is carbamide and azotype carbonamide. So this is the another biggest larger consumption in the food processing industry. The highest quantity which is used is the sweeteners, because in our country, as you are all aware, a lot of people are suffering from diabetes, and the cane sugar or the gud is not being used in many sweets, and these are all this is all getting added as a predominantly in many of the food processing industry. They are adding the sweeteners are added to the foods for flavoring. Some sweeteners other than sugar are added to keep the food energy low, and many people are conscious about the calorific value of the food what they consume, and there are a lot of health consciousness that has come into the society now, and many people are very cautious in buying the food. While buying the food itself, they look into the calorific value of the food, that is what they buy. So keeping that into consideration, low calorific value, so the sweeteners are added to the food and it is processed. And beneficial effects of diabetes mellitus and tooth decay and diarrhea, these are all actually examples of natural sweeteners are nothing but the cane sugar and also the sugar beet and the corn syrup, and the artificial sweeteners such as aspartame and sucralase and saccharin. These are all artificial sweeteners. But there is a big debate that is going on now in our country about the cane sugar also. Since I worked in a sugar factory for more than 22 years, and the problem is many people are spreading there are some harmful effects in using the cane sugar also, and they say cane sugar is not that much good for health. So that debate is going on. I don't want to go into that debate now. That is also one of the additives that is being added, and artificial sweeteners are also added. That all comes in the sweetener category. And the nutrient supplements, this is another area where the another additive which is being added to the food. Nutrient supplements restore values lost in processing or storage, or ensure higher nutritional value than what nature may have provided. And when foods are processed, there may be a loss of some nutrients and additives may be added to restore the original value. For example, vitamin C is added to canned citrus fruits to make up the loss of the vitamin during processing. So this is also a normal routine thing adopted by the food processing industries. Whenever they process the food, there is some loss of vitamins because of the nature of the process what they adopt. The vitamin gets lost in the process, and to replenish that loss, they may add the nutrient supplements as an additive. And thickeners are substances which, when added to the mixture, increase its viscosity without substantially modifying its other properties. Example, corn starch, potato starch, vegetable gums, used as food thickeners, including collagen, egg whites, etc. Other food additives or clarifying agents like bentonite, gelatins, synthetic resins are used to remove haziness or sediments and oxidative deterioration products in fruit juices, beers, and beer and wine. Enzymes are added to bring about desirable changes, and particularly rennin for producing curd and cheese, papain for tenderizing the meat, and pectinase for clarifying the beverages. So enzymes are also added in the food industry, for the food processing industries. Foaming agents like aluminium sulfates and calcium slats are used to keep the tissues of fruits and vegetables crispy. Other food additives, so somebody has asked about jaggery. Jaggery is good for health, and again the nutritive value in the jaggery is also good, and the process, it is a cottage industry in many states, and in our country jaggery is being predominantly used, particularly the jaggery which is produced from palm. That is also considered as a high nutritive value and good for health. and that is slowly replacing the cane sugar. That is also happening. Even in cane sugar, they say the Demerara sugar is there, which we call it as brown sugar. And the Demerara sugar is really good for health because it has a blend of little amount of molasses is getting blended in the normal sugar. And the color also, the IQSA, the value of the sugar color, that is also a little bit higher, but still it is good for health. That's what they say. And freezing agents like liquid nitrogen and dichlorofluoromethane, which are extremely volatile and rapidly evaporate at ordinary temperature, are used to chill the foods. Solvents like alcohol, propylene glycol, and glycerin are used to dissolve suspended flavors, colors, and many ingredients. Packing gases such as inert gases are added to packets of instant foods to prevent oxidative and many other changes. Because in a packet of Lay chips or any kurkure or any such namkeen products, if you buy, normally it will be packed with the gas, so that the product quality is maintained. And if you open it, half of them will be the gas only. So that is packing gases are also. So the numbering of additives, as I explained to you in the beginning, this is the which is used in Europe for all approved additives. The products element areas, the numbers are given here. For example, E100 is curcumin, turmeric. Then E300 is ascorbic acid, and E330 is citric acid. Like that, it goes on. This is a small table to give an indication that the type of additive, the first digit of the E number, and the purpose and the example. And this you can refer it even in the Codex Alimentarius also. This you can refer it. The guidelines are there. Yeah, labeling, again, there is a caution or warning that should be given in the label. Something is harmful there, something is not worthy for children's or kids' consumption, that must be clearly mentioned in the label. And the labeling norms and regulations are to be strictly followed whenever any additives are used in the food which is being marketed. And in our country, even though there are a lot of regulations that is available, there are duplicate products which is there in the market, and they, unfortunate thing, they don't follow any of these labeling regulations, and they float the food, and it is bought by the common public who are not aware of all these things, and they get into some illness, and they even give it to the kids where some harmful additives are there, and the digestive system goes for a six. So at most, care must be taken by the food processing industries. And as consultants, my humble request to all of you here, that please ensure that all the labeling that is being done by the food processing industries, maybe your clients or maybe your friends are there who are in the food processing industry. So kindly please follow the regulations that is being laid down by FSSAI. So FSA come out with the regulations and regulatory things needs to be followed. Particularly in our country, anything and everything which has to be packed and marketed, it must have a FSSAI number, license number, without which no food can be packed or marketed or to be sold to the common public. So that is very, very important. And these are all the numbers which has been assigned for the different types of food additives. And permissible limits of food additives is another area where it is a area of concern. Establishing the permissible limits of food additives, the estimated level of consumption of the food product by the consumers for which the additive is proposed, finding out minimum levels which would produce significant deviation from physiological behavior, legal control over the use of food additives. This can be accomplished only when a list of permitted additives exists with specified safe levels and toxic levels. So these precautions need to be taken into consideration while adding the food additives, whether it is permitted or not, and whether it is harmful, and what is the permissible dose that is allowed to be added in the food. All those things need to be prescribed and it has to be laid down in the quality plan itself of any food processing industry. And particularly the food safety team leader in the food industry is responsible for strictly adhering to all these norms, the concentration or the dosage that what they add in the food while processing. This is very, very important. And stringent labeling on foods, that is declaring the usage of additives in foods and their quantities, and labeling requirements are there and that needs to be strictly followed. Employing trained food inspectors, food control laboratories and reliable analytical methods are of utmost importance for regulation or control over usage of food additives. So the internal laboratory that is there, a quality control laboratory must be there for any food processing industry. And the metrics, what the testing parameters or the analytical things which has to be done by a qualified person. And even if the sample has to be sent to some government accredited laboratories, that has to be sent at the proper frequency and the proper interval. And the result, based on the result, the action has to be taken. And if the result is positive, they can go ahead. If the result is negative, they should not continue further with the processing of that particular thing. They must, in fact, dispose that. So all these stringent measures alone will ensure food safety and security in our country. And this must be strictly followed. And no compromises on quality, no compromises on the dosage of the food additives that has to be added in the food, and the processing parameters has to be strictly followed. And the quality plan must be a dynamic one, and all the latest regulations must be looked into, and all the amendments that is made in the country, somebody has to keep a watch on it and update the quality plan, and also train the people in their own industry or their own factory. That is very, very important. And generally recognized as safe, in short, it is called as GRAS. And this is actually in Europe, this is very, very, the awareness is more. And the next table, next slide, I've just shown what are the GRAS additives and tolerances. This is just for knowledge purpose, I have shared. And the one more concept is called as the acceptable daily intake with respect to the food additive. So if the additives are added in large quantities, it may end up in a health hazard or a health problem for the person who is taking that food or consuming that food. So it is called as ADI. The acceptable daily intake is defined as an estimate of the amount of food additive expressed on a body weight basis that can be ingested on a daily basis over a lifetime without appreciable risk. See, the word appreciable risk is very, very important here. It should not create any health risk for the person who is consuming that food with that food additive. The probability that an event will occur to health without appreciable risk means, based on the current knowledge certainty, that no harm will result even after a lifetime of exposure to the additive concerned. Even suppose you think that the person is going on consuming that food, which is having that food additive throughout his life, there should not be any harmful effect on his health, and there should not be any health risk because of a food additive that is being added. So the acceptable daily intake of some food additives are given here. This has been arrived, and this is, yeah, it is not based on body weight. Actually, it is based on the tolerance of any human being, a healthy human being. What is the total tolerance limit that is there, which will not produce any harmful effect to the human body? That is what is discussed. And here the additive and the ADI and the function that is given here. And the toxicity and the adverse effects of food additives, digestive disorders, diarrhea and stomach pain. Some food additives may cause diarrhea and stomach pain for some people. Even chocolates, if some kids eat some chocolates where it is of a local make, which doesn't follow any of these regulations or that is locally made, definitely there will be a problem of a diarrhea or a stomach pain that is being complained by the kid. So we need to look out for the ingredients in that particular food, what is the food additive that has been added as a preservative, what are all the different ingredients in it, that labeling we have to look for it and check whether there is an FSSAI license is there or not for that particular food. And nervous disorders, hyperactivity, insomnia and irritability, respiratory problems, asthma and sinusitis, and skin problems, that is hives, itching, rashes and swelling. In fact, in this webinar series, if you recall, food allergens was discussed at length. So for some people, there may be allergic, they are allergic to certain food because of the additives what is being added in the food. It may create some skin problems, rashes or some itching. So that is possible. And concerned about food additives, some people believe that some additives cause more trouble than they are worth. One concern is not enough is known about the long-term effect, because there are studies which has been conducted, but the long-term effect, what it will create in the human beings, still there is a area of concern, and still the researchers are going on about many food additives, how it is going to create a harmful effect on the human beings' health. And example is nitrates, which react with amines, is suspected of causing cancer, which is a preservative in meat. And nitrates prevent botulism, which the FDA believe will weigh out the risk of using them. However, the FDA required them to be used in lower quantities. See, the thing is, these preservatives and additives, still the question mark is there, whether is it really safe, whether is it really safe for human consumption. If yes, what is the dosage which can be permitted? And even if in that dosage, if the person is consuming that food for a prolonged duration or throughout his or her lifetime, what will be the harmful effect that will be created because of that additive? Are there any risk in eating so many processed food? So what do you think is there? Are there any risk in eating so many processed foods? So conclusion, preservatives are used to increase the shelf life of the food and maintain the quality for longer time. So it has been reported that chemicals which are used as preservatives have side effects, and the reaction of preservatives can be very mild to life threatening. It is best to eat a preservative free diet if at all it is possible. So natural diet or natural food is what is recommended, but definitely the preservatives can in fact create a mild effect on the ill effect on the health also, but still that question is open. There are for and against views are there. Still it is going, it is a debatable topic. So with this, I'll conclude this my presentation on these additives and preservatives. Now if at all any questions are there in the chat box which I have not seen, my co-presenter Prem can help me in
Mr. Ramkumar, you have a lot of questions to answer. From the beginning, people are closely interesting and watching our session. Some of the questions, let us start from the questions. First is Ms. Kushpu Sethi is asking, what is the time period for the analysis of stabilizing agent, lecithin from NABL or as per FSSAI?
Can you repeat, sir? I'm not able.
Shall I repeat the question?
Yeah.
What is the time period for analyzing of stabilizing agent? Stabilizing agent. It is lecithin from NABL or as per FSSAI. Or, shall you unmute Ms. Kushpu? She can answer the question directly with the.
Please.
Kushpu, please unmute your mic. Kumar sir, you can unmute her. Kushpu madam, please unmute your mic and you can talk.
Yeah, she's unmuted.
Tell me your question now.
Hello.
Yes,
madam. You can ask. You have put a question on the chat box. It is not clear, sir. You can repeat again. You asked about what is the time period for analysis of stabilizing agent.
You are asking specifically lecithin from NABL.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I am asking for testing of lecithin from NABL lab as per FSSAI. What is the time period?
Are you asking whether
frequency of testing lecithin?
Madam, if I am right, please correct me. Are you asking whether the lecithin added food additive added food product has it to be tested under with NABL accredited lab or a normal lab? Is it the question or
lab from NABL lab? It is necessary.
You are asking about frequency of testing. Sir, we can go for next question.
Yeah.
I'm not able to get her communication. She is answering.
No, once she comes back, we'll answer that question, sir. No problem.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Mr. Mohammad Ali is asking another question.
Yeah.
Sir, please explain genetically modified the enzymes added in food products or not?
So genetically modified, that is again a big debatable topic which is going on in the globe. And there are different two school of thoughts again here. Some are for genetically modified food, some are not for genetically modified food, and even in the labeling thing also, the regulatory authorities have come out very clear. Even a genetically modified food, the label must be clearly indicate that it is a genetically modified
food. Ram Kumar sir, sorry, actually he is asking the question genetically modified enzymes.
Genetically modified enzymes,
is it allowed or not?
No. See, if it is from a genetically mod, is it synthetic or natural, or that enzyme, is it extracted from a GM crop, or is it from synthesized artificially in a lab?
He has not mentioned anything on that.
No, that clarity should be there, because that for example, genetically modified crops are there, which is being propagated through genetical engineering, and the production of the crop, it is being multiplied at a very larger scale, and it is being propagated, and there are studies which is saying that even consumption of genetically modified food creates a lot of allergic harmful effects to human beings. Still the study is going on, the clarity is not there, and I think the question, if it is clear, if I'm just taking that the enzymes which are getting extracted from genetically modified crops, if you say yes, definitely there is a provision for it, and if it is an artificial thing, it comes under the artificial synthetic enzymes category.
Okay, sir. Next question from Shish. Aspartame is very harmful for children due to choco. As per EU, it is required to mention aspartame as content on labeling.
No, again, sweetness, especially this saccharin and aspartame, there are ill effects which is harmful to kids. And in the labeling regulatory thing, that has to be, whatever the dosage that is there, permissible dosage only has to be utilized or used by the food processing industry. And there are strict regulations for using this artificial sweetness in the food processing industry. And they have to declare that. And even the permissible dosage, it has to be clearly given in the label. And if these things are not there, definitely, I think even local, I was referring about the local chocolate manufacturers, who in fact, even the ice cream manufacturers, locally they do the ice cream manufacturing in summer, lot of, you can see street vendors who are selling the ice creams, particularly in the schools and other parks and other areas. Those syrups, what they use in the ice cream manufacturing, contains more of saccharin, and the dosage what they give, it is all not there. It is not declared at all, and it is not an FSSAI licensed product. And again, there is a risk of getting harmful effects because of the higher dosage. So better going for a product which is FSSAI, which is having an FSSAI mark on the pack, and also see the contents for it. Then please give it to the children or the kids.
Okay, so next question came from Shirish. If additives are added and it is derived from animals, so it is required to mention logo and labeling as non-meat, that red logo.
Definitely, definitely. Any source of additives which is being added in the food processing, which is from a non-vegetarian origin, and the label, the red label, red dot must be there on the label. That is mandatory. And we have to follow that. Yes.
Next is Mr. Alok Raj. ADA is not based on the body weight easily.
That I answered. See, it is normally, previously it was, it is actually in a normal healthy human being. What is the toxicity levels which will harm the body because of the addition of these food additives? So the toxic effects of these food additives, the research studies are being undertaken, and the World Health Organization also in collaboration with the various bodies and also the international bodies, they fix this particularly acceptable dosage. And that is only being recommended, which is even adopted by the Codex Alimentarius. Yes, sir. You are right.
Agreed. Oh, 1 second, sir. I would like to add Mr. Prem Kumar and Mr. Ram Kumar about
this
point.
Yes, sir.
I would like to add few points here to make everyone understand. Please understand, as per the toxicologists or as per the medicinal things, all chemicals, they do act on body based on the body weight only. Please understand this basic principle. Below a limit, it acts as a medicine. Even that medicine, if you take in a higher site, there are side effects, you say. That side effects are, what is it? These are hazardous things. So all chemicals are toxic beyond a particular limit. And how does they act? It all act based on the body weight. For a bee, a fine fogging system can kill it. Same chemical, if you fog it, the snakes and rabbits, and they won't be killed. You need little more volume of the same. And then when it comes to elephant, it needs more volume or weight of the compound. So definitely the chemicals act on you based on your body weight. The resultant will be based on that. The medication is also done by the same way. You take your child to hospital, they take the weight of the child first before the dose is fixed. Same is the case if you want to kill anyone, the poison. So all these chemicals affect the human body based on its individual body weight. Please understand this basic point. Then you can calculate. Rest all what Mr. Ram Kumar has stated, that is average daily intake by anyone and average body weight. Based on that, they have come to the conclusion of the acceptable limits. I think I have made it clear. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Apajirav, sir. You have made it very, very clear. In fact, you have made my job easy. In fact, I recall one movie where the apple seeds are also toxic, in fact, for some people. If it is consumed mistakenly in larger quantities, it will lead to death also.
Yes, it has cyanide. Apple seed has cyanide.
Yes, yes. In one movie also, they have taken this as one of the key things. Yes, sir. Yes,
next question. We can go for next question from Sanjeev Kumar. It's somewhat a hard question to answer. Anyway, we can make a try. How can we increase shelf life of wheat flour from 3 months to 6 months?
Shelf life of which product, sir?
Wheat flour.
Wheat flour. Achha. Yeah. Shelf life of normally the wheat, we can, that is being stored, every natural product has its own shelf life, and the product that is being derived from all these natural products like wheat grains is the basic raw material for the wheat flour. Definitely there is a shelf life for all that. If you add more of preservatives and more of additives, definitely, as the toxicology part is there, will be toxic. Anything which is beyond the affordable limit, definitely the body will tend to react and it may even succumb to that. So I think the research only will have to prove whether the shelf life can be improved or not, without compromising the harmful effects on the human beings. Any shelf life improvement, the basic thumb rule must be without compromising on the human consumption or without compromising on the health of the person, health of a normal human being, anything can be done. Nothing harm in it. I think studies are there, but I'm not very sure about it. Sorry, no, I'm not able to give you a perfect answer for that question, sir.
Fine, sir. So next is Mr. Vimalan Mani. Some of the additives are derived from egg. So shall we have to make allergen on label? Allergen information on label?
No, allergen definitely it is also part of the which portion of egg they are using it. That is very important, and in how much quantity, that is very, very important. The proportion or the percentage that is getting added to the total food, and is it added because of the nutritive value or what purpose that additive is getting added, that also plays a major role. And the quantity and the purpose for which that additive is added, that determines whether it is it comes into the falls into the allergen category or not. I think Appaji Rao can.
Yes, sir. I just unmuted myself to answer the little supplement that answer to you for what you have stated. Friends, there are two things. Whether it is for any purpose, if the allergen is coming into line, then it is an allergen compound. So definitely, a person who is affected with egg, if he has an egg allergy, please understand again, the question is a very big thing. If a person has an allergy to egg, it doesn't mean that he will have allergy from all other allergic compounds. A person who is not having allergy to peanut can have peanut, but he may be allergic to egg. So these are very typical things to understand this way. So allergen, one thing, in India, so far, the requirement of declaring as a warning on the label with respect to allergen has not yet been formed. But outside India, it is definitely safe. So if your market is within India, presently you just give in your ingredients that egg compound is there. That's all. And because it is non-vegetarian considered, so brown color, red circle and the square will be there. But if you are selling outside India, definitely if it is going to Australia where the label on allergen, if it is going to America or Canada, you definitely have to give this warning on your packet label. I think that is clear now.
One more thing, sir. Mr. RP screen person also telling, once we are using any of the egg derivatives on our food product, we need to declare that as a non-veg. We need to make a regular logo on this, no?
Yeah, that's what. If anything, what we have described as a non-vegetarian, that will be bound to have a red color logo. Whether all major component may be vegetarian, but if you add this additive which is non-vegetarian, then the logo has to be of non-vegetarian. That is the reason why earlier rennet was used, we know that, for cheese making and all. Then there was another compound which was used from stomach of calf for ice cream making, gelatin and all. So they were not given these things. Now they have done away with that and they have come with a natural like and synthetic additives into that. That is the reason why they have shifted from there into this. Definitely, if you add even an iota of non-vegetarian into vegetarian, whether in the form of a color or in the form of this thing, definitely they say that it has to be having a non-vegetable source of compound in it. So the logo of that brown or a green stands in India very strictly.
Okay.
Sir, thank you for that information, sir. In fact, other than plants and synthetic, no, anything which is from a non-vegetarian source, the labeling has to be strictly followed.
Sir, that's all for the question and answer session.
Thank you very much. I thank all.
Sir, I have put one question. Can you please answer?
Yes.
Hello.
It's in the question. It is not under no. What is negligible period after this business for it? It is not at all allowed. It is not recommended. I see your question, Mr. Ganesh.
Okay. Yeah, I want
what
answer.
What was the question, Mr. Prem?
Yeah.
I can read it now.
Shall I still? Yeah.
Yes. I can tell. You can tell. Please tell.
Yeah.
The question.
Yeah,
Prem sir, let him say the question. Yeah. You can say the answer. It will be beneficial for all the participants.
Yes.
Yes. Sir, my general question as a consumer, I always see that each food item or has got a expiry date or best before date.
Two different things.
Sometimes we miss the
date. Hold on. In food, there is no expiry date. There are only two dates, either used before or best before. So this is as per FSSAI terminology. So
used before,
if the shelf life of the product is within 1 week, it is to be given as used by. Yes. Before. And if it is having more than week to whatever the food business operator declares, then it has to be best before. There is no expiry on food. It's only on medicines. Am I clear?
There
is no expiry date in food, sir.
Best before date.
Best before means you have to eat it before it, otherwise you may have some effect afterwards. So they are not saying expiry.
Okay. So
few people may resist it, few people may not resist it. That is the reason why it is best before.
Yeah, but the only thing I want to know whether there is any margin the manufacturer keeps, like some people without.
Yes. You see,
consume.
No. Fundamentally, this is all a practical thing as a question what you have asked. Everybody wants to play safe, so they definitely will be keeping margin at their end.
Yeah, that's all.
So don't worry on that, because otherwise food business operator is at risk. He is the responsible person for that.
Exactly.
Yes.
Mr. Ganesh, precisely I can say, when we are consuming this food stuff after the best before date, it is purely on the consumer risk. Okay. Therefore, it is the manufacturer indicating that after this best before date, if we are consuming on this food stuff, it may cause some side effect or some, it may not be the nutrition value as it is mentioned on the label. Okay, that's what they're using language based before. But again, it's a consumer risk.
Okay. So it's always to avoid any food which has already crossed the best before date, correct?
Yes, absolutely. Yes. Absolutely.
You are right.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Sir, I have one question. We are using some additives in nutraceutical, why we are making nutraceutical. And in nutraceutical, most of the vitamins, they have a shelf life. But when we are using as an additive, there is no shelf life. So when any food safety officer, they took some sample, how we can validate that product? Because when they are testing, the whole product, whether it is a vitamin or additives. So can you give me some guidelines for that?
Yours is a very specific question. I would like to rehear that, understand it much better. It's not so easy to answer your typical question. I do not know why you say there is no, if it is a vitamin C in pharma, you say that they have an expiry date.
Yes.
But the same company is providing to food industry. Food industry doesn't develop any other specifically vitamin C for food use.
But it is a common preparation.
Poonamji, one minute. See, the thing is, in the nutraceutical compound, normally the additives what they add is either a chemical food additive or a biotechnologically produced food additive.
Yeah.
In your case, it's not very clear, or rather, I am not getting it clear.
Yes.
What is the type of food additive that you are adding to your nutraceutical product?
Sir, both we can use in the nutraceutical.
Because it follows a different route. I am saying the chemical food additive is a synthetic one.
Yeah.
Okay. That actually, if it is added to a nutraceutical compound, definitely the norms that has to be followed is typically different. If it is a biotechnologically produced additive, then like lactic acid or bacteriocins or a xylitol, if you are using these type of food additives in your nutraceutical product, definitely it is having a separate norms to be followed for the shelf life that what you are asking now. Okay. I think as Apajit has said, it's a very in-depth topic. It has to be discussed at length. Thank you, ma'am.
Sir, can I ask a question?
Yes,
Umesh Naik here.
Yeah.
I have put on the chat, I wanted if you can please throw some light on this carryover principle. What I meant is, sometimes there could be an ingredient one is using or wants to use which may have an additive, whether it is allowed in the final product or not, and in either case, how is the labeling managed in this?
Can I hear your question again, Mr. Naik?
What I meant was, there could be ingredient one is wanting to use which has some additive or a preservative.
You want to use either additive or a preservative, okay?
No, we want to use ingredient as a raw material.
Okay, as a raw material. Ingredient as a raw material. Can you explain the difference between the two?
I actually meant the same.
You are using one ingredient into one of the compounds. So what is the question now? Can I catch that?
And sir, sorry to intervene. If I understand his question correct, he is asking whether the carryover is permitted or not for additives.
Correct.
Correct, no?
Yes, please.
It actually depends on...
See, in the finished product, what are the carryover leftover? As per the FSSAI, they are the limits in the finished product only, not in the intermittents.
Exactly.
Please understand this point fundamentally. The limit which is prescribed acceptable norms are in the finished product. Please keep that in mind. Not in the raw material. If you are adding more and your process is not able to remove it, it should be in a position to remove it to the level which the finished product should be having, not more than that.
Yes.
If you don't have a process, then don't use that limit. You have to restrict in the raw material itself that limit.
The limit as well as the permission to use it in the final product.
Yes.
Sir, in other words, the presence of that additive which is due to the carryover, if it is within that prescribed dosage, then it will be permitted. Otherwise, it will not be permitted, sir.
Yes, I generally had this feeling and I just wanted to...
Sir. Good that you raised this question. Yes. Because the final product will be put to test. So in that test, whatever the test results are coming, that should reflect if it is of the allowable limit that is there, definitely that carryover is permitted. That is a inference that what you have to get.
Understood. Supposing thank you.
It is not
thank
there, then the carryover is not permitted. That's all.
Thank you, sir.
In this, I want to emphasize the point of Mr. Upadhyay, sir. You can add this kind of ingredient in as a raw material. If you have any in-between process to remove or changing that, if it is not getting reflected on the final product, no need to worry about that. That you can add that ingredient and can proceed the process. Until it is not reflected on the finished product.
There is one terminology which was not used here, which is called as process aids. All process aids, if you add, should be removed and should not be present in the finished product.
Exactly. It should not get reflected in the final product.
So that term, when in that case, that is called processing aids in food industry.
Exactly. So I think time up, sir. I think we have taken extra 5 minutes. Thank you. Thank you very much for this wonderful opportunity to share the thought process about additives and preservatives. A wonderful interaction by a very interactive audience. Thank you, all the participants. Have a nice evening. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Apajirav, sir. Special thanks to you. And my co-presenter, Prem Kumar Jaivin, and also the host of this event, Sri Kumar from CCC. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir.
Thanks, Ram Kumar, sir, for the excellent presentation.
Very nice presentation. Lot of audience participated. They stay until the last minute. They asked lot of good questions. Really, I like to thank Mr. Upadhyay Rao sir for his wonderful guidance and lot of valuable information in this session. Thanks to all. Thanks, Mr. Kumar. And thanks, Mr. Ram Kumar sir. Thanks to all the participants.
Thank you. Thank you, Ram Kumar sir and Prem Kumar sir. So next session is on Monday. The topic is food safety in terms of consumers and homemakers. And we have two sessions left Monday and Tuesday. With this, we end this series of webinars. So see you all on Monday. The link and the timing remains the same. Thank you all.
Thank you.